Feminist Creativus presents A Word for Every Generation That Knows No Fashion.
Greetings. I hope and trust I find you well. We have one more experience to consider from the mountain of God, Horeb or Sinai. As God has conversations with his manservant Moses, and today we want to zero in on Exodus, the chapter is 3. We want to look at just verse 12. It reads as follows. God said, I will surely be with you, and these shall be the sign to you that I have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall serve God on this mountain. May the good Lord bless the reading of his word. Amen. And let us spend a moment together in prayer. Kind and gracious Father in the heavens above, thank you, dear Lord, for the privilege of calling upon your name. Dear Father, throughout the week, we have sought to minister to Pharaoh. Some of our escapades didn't go so well. We remained with questions, is the Lord with us on this mission? And we are glad to find assurance that you surely be with us. Be with us even now as we consider your word. This has been my prayer and our combined and corporate prayer of faith. In Jesus' name, come into our hearts, come in to dwell. Amen. My dear friends, as we step into the weekend, I just want to raise 5 points. And at point number one, listen how God opens with an assurance to Moses. And he says, Moses, I will surely be with you. You know, God has a habit of answering questions that we have not asked. I can imagine at the back of Moses' mind, he's asking himself this question, what is God's plan? As I go out there, am I surely going to be accompanied? Will I be alone as I face Pharaoh and the rest of the children of Israel? Now God answers that question. He says, I will surely be with you. As the disciples were setting off on the Great Commission, which we are still on, Christ also answered this question to his disciples, and he answers it for you and for me. He says, Lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. Christ gives us the same assurance that was given at Moses. We get a repeat of it. God will surely be with us as we go into this weekend. May we be reminded that God will take care of you. This reminded me of the song, God will take care of you no matter what may be the tide. God will see you through. May God see us through. May God be with us. May God never leave our side. May God even carry us on his heavy and broad shoulders. At point number two, notice this other interesting point that I want to zero in on. He says the sign that you are going to have is a sign that you receive. A sign you receive when the job is done. Many a time we want to be given a sign so that we can go on and do the job. But God puts this in reverse and he says, Moses, you go and do the job. When you have done the job, I'll then show you the sign that I have sent you. God calls us into action so that when we are done, we can then receive the sign. What is the sign? Well done, faithful and good servant. Enter ye into the glory that the Father has prepared for you. We get the sign at the end. It is, I think it was Gideon. He's the only one who managed to get a sign before he actually went into service. But Moses is told, as for you, come over, do the job, and when you are done, I will then show you the sign. I found that to be very interesting, that many of us are going to go through this whole exercise of evangelizing, go through the exercise of ministering, only to learn at the end that indeed we have been working for the Lord. Some of us are going to get to the end and we shall be told, depart from me, ye doers of iniquity. When we have spoken to the Pharaohs, when we have brought the children of Israel outside, the sign is given as an affirmation that what you have been doing for the Lord. For it is not all who say, Lord, 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 who will enter the kingdom of heaven. At point number three, notice this. God says to Moses, I need you to bring the children of Israel out of Egypt, then I will give you the sign. This got me thinking, you know, many a time we have thought, you know, Moses was supposed to take the children of Israel into Canaan. And because he struck the rock, God did not take him into Canaan, but instead took him to heaven. As I was reading this, I'm reading in between the lines that God is already telling Moses, Moses, your job description, your prerogative, particularly, is to just take them out of Egypt. God already knows these things. And he says to Moses, when you have taken them out of Egypt, not when you have taken them into Canaan, not when they have arrived in Canaan, but only when you take them out of Egypt, thereafter, you will come and serve the Lord. The Lord has set a mile for us to run. The Lord has set a destination for us to reach. The Lord has set a mission for us to achieve. And he says, my son, my daughter, yours is to bring them out. Joshua will take them in. Many a time we want to run the whole race without passing on the baton. When we have done our 100 meters, pass on to the other runner so that he can do the second lap. When you have done the marathon, you may want to pass on to the other runner so that they can continue on this relay. It is not a one-man show. And God says, Moses, Moses, yours is to take them out of Egypt. And I hope we have understood our mission throughout the week. God at times has been calling upon us. Yours is to go out there to that beloved of yours who remains stuck in sin, stuck in captivity. Take them out. I will see as to their destination from there. You just go and share the message of them to come out of Babylon. When they come out, I will show them where to go. I will elect people who see them through. They are not our people. We do not own them. God is the one who sets their destination. At point number five, at point number four, I love the way God now speaks to Moses. And he says, Moses, when you are done, you will serve God on this mountain. Allow me to just blend point number four and five there. You will serve God on this mountain. What is God calling us to do today? He says, come, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. We are called to service in this life. When we are done serving him in this life, get to the book of Revelation, it says, then I saw those who were redeemed from the world. What did they do? They continued to follow the Lamb whithersoever he went. We continue to be in the service of the Lamb in this life, this side of heaven, and in the life to come, the other side of these heavens that are above us. God calls us to a life of service. There is no retirement in ministering for the gospel. There is no retirement even in ministering in the heavens above. We may have a brief moment of rest should death find us before Christ does. But in and above all, we are called to a life of service. At point number five, as we wrap up, these I've already indicated. Moses is told, you shall come back and serve the Lord on this mountain. Did you know that in heaven, the temple of God is on a mountaintop? And as we shall near the mountain of God, we shall find that the book of Isaiah in chapter 6 is true. When the angels say, holy, holy, holy to the Lamb that is slain, they sing their praises to God. They do so on the mountain. And as we approach the mountain of God, Zephaniah says, God shall now burst into song and welcome us with a solo. God shall sing in harmony and in praise and in celebration as we make it into the streets paved with gold, as we make it to the land of Beulah land, as we make it to the mountain of God, so that we can be of service, of service. This is where Lucifer, before he turned into Satan, used to serve. It was on the mountain of God. And God says, my children, just as I promised Moses, that he shall come and serve on the mountain of God, so shall you come and serve on the mountain of God. Remember, while you are at it, while you're still serving on earth, doing your apprenticeship, while you're still serving on earth, doing your attachment, while you're doing service on earth as a graduate trainee, I will surely be with you. Point number two, while you are serving on earth, go with an abundance of faith. You are not alone. I am surely with you, but I will then give you a sign, lots of signs. Number one, the heavenly kingdom. I'll give you another sign. I'll give you a stone with a name that only you and Christ knows. I'll give you another sign. I'll give you a crown when you get to heaven. I'll give you another sign. I'll give you a mention when you get to heaven. I'll give you another sign. I'll give you the fruits from the tree of life. I'll give you another sign. I will give you the leaves for the healing of the nations. All these are signs that are awaiting us upon the completion of our tasks. At point number three, Moses is being told, yours is to take them out. Let us be willing to run the race. And like Paul say, I have run the good race and I have finished it. There awaits for me a crown and life eternal in the heavens to come. Let this be our aspiration. Do your bit and do it well. When you do it so well, appreciate that. At point number four, you are serving God in this life and in the life to come, where we shall serve him on the mountain of God. We are still marching to Zion. Let us meet again on Monday morning, and may the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord prosper you. And may the Lord re-energize you for service as you continue on his mission next week.